Mr. Nagat Jha, Assistant Professor at ITICT Department of LJ Institute of Engineering and Technology. Welcome to the third lecture of Unit 2, Agile Development. So, in previous lecture, we have learned about various agile process model and in which we have discussed extreme programming and industrial extreme programming. So, now in today's lecture, we will continue to the agile process model in which we are going to learn another two agile process model. So, agile process we are going to learn today is ASD, that is Adaptive Software Development, and second is DSDM, that is Dynamic System Development Method. So, let's start with the ASD model. Adaptive Software Development. The Adaptive Software Development approach was proposed by Jim Highsmith. ASD is a direct outgrowth of an earlier agile framework, that is Rapid Application Development. In Unit 1, we have already learned about RAD model, that is Rapid Application Development model. So ASD is a evolution to that particular model. Its aim is to enable teams to quickly and effectively adapt to changing requirements or market needs by evolving their products with lightweight planning and continuous learning. So, its actual aim is to enable team. For what purpose? To quickly and effectively adapt to the changing requirements. So, as we all know, there is a change every day, there is a change in a requirement of a end user. So if customer needs something else, then when the developer is already proposed, then they have to be adapt any changes. So as per the end user's requirement, developer need to change the product. So the aim of ASD is to enable team to quickly and effective manner to adapt changing requirements or a market needs. So what are going in market? So based on that needs, market needs, developer have to change the product. And by what purpose? By evolving their product with a lightweight planning and continuous learning. Okay. Now, this is a technique for building complex software system using iterative approach. So this is also iterative approach. So in iterative approach, the whole project is divided into sub-project, and sub-projects are delivered to the end user. So this technique is built for a complex software development, and ASD focus on working in a collaboration and team self-organization. So if you have a large team and you have to work in a collaborative way, then you can use the ASD model. So as we already discussed in various models, they have a phases, okay, life cycle phases. So ASD also have a life cycle phases. Phases are categorized into three phases, that is speculation, second is a collaboration, and third is a learning. So what is speculation? So speculation is the initial phase of the adaptive software development model. So project is initiated in this phase, and after that planning is conducted according to the requirements. So in this phase, project is begin, and then based on the customer requirement, the planning is done, that in how much time you will going to complete that product or a project. So in this cycle, planning mainly three types of information is used. So for planning, you will use three types of information. What are that information? Information is like customer's mission statement. Then second is project constraint. In project constraint, delivery dates, then budget, then user description, and so on. And last is basic requirement of a project. So in speculation phase, you will define three things, that is customer mission statement. So what customer actually needs from that product. Then project constraint. So which are the delivery date, in how much budget developer have to develop that software, and what are the user definition and specification and basic requirements of the project. So what are some basic requirements? So this is about speculation phase. Okay, then next is a collaboration phase. Basically, the motivated people are working on collaboration for any software development. So in this, collaboration among the members of development team is a key factor. So here whole the team have to work with each other. So it also encompasses communication and teamwork, but also emphasizes individualism. Okay, so here individuals person are also matter. So their thinking, their motive for their project, all things are considered for software development. So it also encompasses communication and teamwork, but also emphasizes individualism of any team member. Then for successful collaboration and coordination, it is necessary to have a following qualities in every individual. Okay, so let's take an example. If you are going to develop any software, okay, so what you will do, you will divide whole the project into your team member, but it should have some qualities. Okay, if someone is good in coding, then you will give coding part to them. If someone is good in a designing module, then you will give the designing phase to particular person. Okay, so for individual, there are some qualities have in team member. So what are that qualities? Qualities like assist each other without resentment. Okay, so if you know how to code or how to design, then you can guide your friend or you can guide your team member that this is going to be happen or this will help you. So you have to support your team member or you have to assist your team member. Then next is a work hard. So every individual have to work hard for that software development. Then possess the requirement skill set. So if you are doing coding or testing, then you should know what is actually coding and what you have to code and what you have to design. So it required a skill set. Then communication problem and help each other. So for better understanding and for clear understanding, for clear any software requirement, you have to communicate with each other or you have to communicate with your team members. So with communication, you can solve many problems and you can help each other. And another quality is criticize without any hate. So you have to criticize with each team member. So these are some qualities that should be in any individual team member. So this is all about collaboration phase. Now next is a learning phase. So as we all know, there is nothing any age limit for learning. Okay, so if I want to learn, then I can learn easily. And if your grandmom want to learn, then she also learn. Okay, so there is no any age limit for learning. So this phase is also similar to that phase, that it challenges all stakeholders and it also emphasizes in learning new skill and techniques. Okay, so if you are working on a live project, then you have to learn new skill. If the working environment is new for you and new techniques, okay. And for an example, if you are changing any company from one company to another, then there is a huge difference between both environment. Okay, so if you have worked in one company and if you have moved to the another company, then changing environment in techniques, okay, so both the things are different. So you have to learn a new skill and a new technique for software development. Okay, so there are three ways by which the team member can learn. The first way is a focus group. In focus group, the feedback from the end user is obtained for developed component. Okay, if you are a developer and you have delivered that one end of component to the end user, then it gives some feedback for that component. And if there is any requirement in change, then you can easily adopt that change. So you can learn from the end user. So this is the focus group learning. Then second is a formal technical review. As a developer or as a coder or a programmer, you have any issues with your software development process. Okay, so once your you have any problem, then you can consult your team leader or a project leader. Okay, so with meeting with your team or project leader, you can easily adopt the changes or you can easily got your solution. Okay, so this review is conducted for better quality of your software development. And the last way is a postmortem. So what is that postmortem? The team analyzes its own performances and makes appropriate improvement. So in this learning phase, the team ownself perform their own development. So if you are a developer, then you can develop the product and you also analyze your own result. Okay. And after that result, you can easily got that which mistake you have done, and then you can change according to your mistake. So this is called postmortem. Okay. So these are three ways of learning, that is focus group by using end user's feedback, then formal technical review with meeting, okay, and then postmortem by own performance measure. So this is about all three phases of adaptive software development. Now what that three phases collaborate? So speculate, collaborate and learn cycle as a whole thing. Okay, so as you observe from the speculate, collaborate and learn phase cycle, it is obvious that the three phases are non-linear and overlap. Each that phases are depending on other thing. So we observe something from an adaptive framework. What we have observed? We have observed that it is difficult to collaborate without learning or to learn without collaborating. Okay, so if you are not learning, then you can't collaborate, and if you are not collaborate, then you can't learn. Then second is, it is difficult to speculate without learning or to learn without speculating. Okay, and third is, it is difficult to speculate without collaborating or to collaborate without speculating. Okay, so these all the phases are depending on each other, so they are non-linear and overlap phases. Next, advantages and disadvantages. So all the process model have some advantages and disadvantages. So advantages are software increment adjustment. Here we have already discussed that whole the project is divided into sub product, and in every increment we will give our product to the end user. Okay, so software increment adjustment. So here in this model, you are adjust how many increment are going to be covered. Then rapid and complex software development. So this is the good advantage, that you can easily solve rapid and complex software, and it also integrate testing into every stages. So this is better for a software development. So if you are use unit testing in each and every phases of your, or each and every iteration of your product, then a good quality can be achieved. And another advantage is, it also encourage more transparency between developer and client. As we have discussed, client is always participate in every phases of software development. So it is the advantage that it also encourage more transparency. So there is a transparency between developer and client. So there is nothing, any hidden thing in software development. So these are some advantages. Now disadvantages. So what are the disadvantages? Disadvantage is that there is a lack of emphasis on necessary designing and documentation. Okay, so in this model we have disadvantage, like in designing and in documentation we have some issues. Then it is difficult to access the effort required at the beginning of the SDLC. As we discuss in SDLC, there is a first phase is a requirement gathering. So for ASD, it is a very difficult task, or it takes many more efforts for requirement gathering. So this is the disadvantage. Then next is a integrates testing into every stages, which can add to a project cost. In advantage, we have discussed that integrate testing into every stage. Integration of testing in every stage is a good thing, but it leads to the project cost. So it is also a disadvantage of this model. So this is all about adaptive software development model. Now, next topic is next agile process model, that is DSDM, dynamic system development method. So what is this dynamic system development method? Dynamic system development method is an approach to system development which, as the name suggests, develop the system dynamically. So if your system is dynamically developed, then you can use dynamic system development method for your software development. So its name suggests it develops system in a dynamic way. So it is a dynamic system development method. Then it is an associate degree agile code development approach that provides a framework for building and maintaining system. So it provides framework for constructing any code, and you can also maintain system. And then it is an iterative and incremental approach that emphasizes continuous user and customer involvement. So this is the same as the previous model, that your whole product is divided into a sub-product, and in sub-product you will give some increment after delivery to the end user. Okay, so an iterative and incremental approach that emphasizes continuous user customer involvement. So in every phases, customer or end user is participating in your software development process. Then goal. So what is the goal of DSDM? The goal is to deliver project on time and on budget while adjusting for changing requirement along the way. As a end user, you all know that we need some product or a software within time limit and within our own budget. So DSDM have a same goal, that they can deliver project on time and on budget. And if there is a change by customer, then it always along with the way of construction of your software. Then DSDM is a methodology that prioritizes schedule and quality over functionality. So here the main key factor in this model is they always prioritize schedule, that in how much time you will deliver your product to the customer and how your quality should be maintained. So this model focus on schedule and quality rather than a functionality. Yeah. It is also a straightforward framework and it is simple and extendable. Yeah. So this is about dynamic system development method. This model also have a life cycle. Okay. So phases of DSDM is total 5 phases. First phase is a feasibility study. Then second is a business study. Then functional model iteration, then design and build iteration, and then implementation. So these are 5 phases of dynamic system development method. So in feasibility study stage, so here in this phase, business requirement and constraint are identified. So developer can easily identify that is there any feasible requirement are there or not. Customer can give any requirement, but that requirements are feasible or not, that will be decided in feasibility study phases. Then next is a business study phase. Here in this phase, the functional and informational requirements are identified so that the business value for the requirements are defined. So we can say that in this phase, basic application architecture is built. Okay. Next is a functional model iteration. Here in this phase, the basic functionality of the particular software is demonstrated to the customer. So by constructing or developing suitable increment, you can demonstrate the product to the end user or a customer. So they will give some feedback according to that. Then next is a design and build iteration. Basically, each prototype is revisited by functional model iteration to ensure that whether the requirements are satisfied by the software component or not. And in parallel, design and build iteration are also developed. So this phase is parallelly carried out during functional model iteration phase. And the last phase is implementation. In this phase, the software increment is placed into the working environment. And if there is a change or an improvement in your product, then your iteration is taken further for improvement. So this is about the five phases of dynamic system development method. Now, advantages and disadvantages. So advantages of DSDM is users are highly involved in the development phase. Okay, so in each and every phase is user participation must be there. Then basic functionality is delivered within a very short time. So this model have a basic functionality that you have to deliver a basic feature in a very short time. Then it provides ease access for developer to end user. So developer and end user are easily communicate with each other and transparency is maintained. Then projects are delivered on time within a specific budget. So here your project is delivered to the end user on a given time period on and on a given budget. So these are the advantages of dynamic system development method. And there are also disadvantages. So first disadvantage is sometimes it is costly. So there is a continuous participation of customer is there. So if customer gives continuous changing in that software, then it leads to the costing. Okay. Then it may not suitable for small organization. So if you have a small team and you have to work with a limited members or a limited developers, then you can't select DSDM for software development. Then it is not suitable for one-time project. One-time project is similar to that kind of project that you just have to develop it and hand over to the customer. There is no maintenance or nothing is going to happen in the future. So if you have this kind of project development, then you can't use dynamic system development method for software development. Then if users and developer both need to be trained, so this is the most disadvantage that the user, the end user and the developer who is going to develop your software both need to be trained. So if they don't have any particular skill, then the software development is not going to happen. So these are the advantages and disadvantages of dynamic system development method. So what we have learned in today's lecture, we have completed another two agile software process model, that is ASD, adaptive software development, and next is a DSDM, that is dynamic system development method. In next lecture, we will continue with another agile process model. Thank you.